Okay, without further ado, I am taping for the second time today on this day, September. It should be, what, 5th, something like that? Yeah, September 5th. And I need to do this just to reassure everyone that I'm still standing and I'm backing up what I said in the previous video. The Pope and President, the Antichrist and the Antichrist agenda, the New World Order, September 2015. In this video is an extraordinary amount of information that has never really been put together before in this world, outlining the large parameters of what's taking place here. And so Holy Spirit advised me to tape again here and just to reassure everyone that, yeah, I'm still fine. I'm still standing. I'm okay. It's okay to think this way. It's okay to see this. It's okay to recognize what's going on. And I broke so many taboos there, you know. It's just like, it's completely apocalyptic. The number of taboos, I can't even count them. They're so severe. You know, we're not supposed to think this way. We're not supposed to be able to see this. It's taboo. You know, authority is supposed to be able to conceal what it's up to, and we're supposed to go along with it. So, in viewing this, that previous video, Pope and President, Antichrist Agenda for New World Order 2015, September 2015, you might be shaken up. You're saying, gosh, wow, this is just too much. So, I just have to bring this reassurance here that it's fine, it's not too much. Now, I'll also do a little bit of further explanation. Keep in mind now, this is very important, that the Pope has tacitly made climate change a religious doctrine, okay, of the Catholic Church. It's the central doctrine now. The Pope has replaced eternal life with climate change as the central tenet of the Catholic faith. He's completely to steer the Church away from the mission that they claim Jesus gave him, which isn't exactly true. He's the bad shepherd, to say the least. That's the bad shepherd. That's the wolf in sheep's clothing. Climate change is now religious dogma rooted in the Catholic Church. The Pope says this is the most important issue we face. We must, you know, solve this. We must, you know, he has a completely humanistic, mortal mind perspective. I already excommunicated. He's the ex-pope, excommunicated pope. And the church age has already ended, so you don't have to listen to anything the Pope really says. The church age has already ended. Jesus is already back in this world, and this dissolves. You know, all religions are now dissolved, basically. But from the standpoint of, you know, Christianity, let's say Christianity, it's dissolved. Jesus is back and will speak through, have his ways of speaking through his close apostles, disciples, whatever, you know, those who have been listening to him, and be reoriented towards the gospel of eternal life. Now, Jesus tells us we're not even in this world. What the perception we're having is just an image. We're just an image. Images can't see. Images cannot really see at all, but the perception we think we're having is just projection upon imagery. It's not true perception at all. We're not even in a world. We're not in the world at all. We've never been in the world. This is, the world doesn't happen to us. This is nonsense. So, religious dogma and then secular humanist dogma are now the same. Are now the same. Isn't that something? You see what has happened right under our noses, but we didn't miss it. And there's smoke coming, very nice smoke coming from somewhere. Wow, just like yesterday there was a grass fire and a smoke. Now this smoke is coming from somewhere, which is kind of odd. I never really smelled that in this area. Some kind of wood burning fireplace. That's, huh. So, again, the Pope has put at the heart of Catholicism, and really Christianity and human religion, this so-called dogma of climate change, But it's more than that. It's way more than that. It's a call to extraordinary action. This is a religious mission. Now, it goes so far as to be extended. If this is at the heart of the mission now of the church, it absolutely goes to follow that if you do not participate in this, you're going to be damned. All right, you're not going to get to heaven. If this is the central, most important issue that obedience to God takes, is to do everything you can to stop climate change and all sorts of problems with the earth, then obviously if you don't do this, you're disobeying God and you can't possibly get into heaven. Do you see how insidious the situation is right now? More insidious than we realize. And it's essentially saying that the world is happening to us. It's not. We're happening to the world. There is no world, actually. This is just, we collect an environment around us that supports the image of what we think we have ourselves, of our identity, of ourselves. And what we call this world is just this pretending to be, not be spirit, to be dead. We have this image belief that we're dead. And we have just fashioned this imagery, this environment to support this nonsense. So literally, the dogma will be, and this is the danger, is the secular humanistic dogma and the Catholic dogma are now the same at its heart, the most important principle, the organizing principle, which means the mandate from God, basically. The mandate from the universe, this is secular humanist will say, well, it's a mandate from our conscience, from the universe, from the conscience, from, well, they'll say Mother Earth. This is their, you know, goddess religion will say, well, Mother Earth, this is the mandate. We must heal Mother Earth. And it's exactly the same as the Catholic mandate now at its core. So both will agree that any, you know, those who are obstructionist or don't go along, you know, do not embrace this religion, it'll be a mandatory religion with penalties. Those who do not go along with it are damned. They have turned their backs on God and deserve to be rejected by society and all the punishments. They will believe in just punishment of them. Extraordinary, right? Pretty shocking. There's already this new world order, new world religion in place, actually. And it has to do with what they call Mother Earth. And those who do not embrace this will be treated very harshly because they see as tantamount to rejecting the will of God, the will of Mother Earth, the will of the universe, the will of our conscience, etc., etc. And so society will say we have the right then to completely exclude them from society. Of course, keep in mind that those who are following the path of enlightenment have the right to exclude these knuckleheads, you know, egomaniacs from our company temporarily until they, you know, come out of their severe delusion. We also have that right. And we can take that step also. We don't have to perpetually cohabit with, you know, lunatics, actually, which is what they really are, is their dualistic, severe egomaniacs, still listening to the advice of a continuity fear, which comes from arrogance. Still believing that they're humans, that they're bodies, that they're people, that they're living in a world, you know, that they have form, that there's time, space, process, and form. Still believing in spiritualizing mortal mind, mortal existence. Still believing in the dream of death, trying to beautify it, etc. Still doing all of this. We don't have to continue to, you know, cohabit with such nonsense. You know, put them on probation. Put them on probation. Put them on temporary probation. That's perfectly acceptable. So it's tough love time from our standpoint. It's tough love time where I had to put someone on block for the first time in my life. I've never blocked anybody from speaking freely in my life, but I realize it's time that if something is being intentionally disruptive and trying to steer it, you know, in the wrong direction, it's time to block it. It's time to block it. This is our tough love. We can be tough too. You have to realize that they don't believe this, but they'll soon find out otherwise. We have every right to be tough. We can be tough. We don't have to hang around with this nonsense. We're not going to find ourselves excluded from what we really want. And what we really want, the environment we really want, is supports what we believe about ourselves, which is we are eternal life. And there's nothing other than that. We're not anything other than that. So we will get the environment that supports that. Absolutely. And when they, you know, begin to change their tune, then we'll go from there and see how that is. But I can bet. I mean, it's amazing. I was shocked. I heard this talk about climate change, and the people feel that if anyone denies this, they're absolutely insane. It's not a matter of denying it. It's a matter of what's the importance of it. Is it really that important? Is it all important? Is it settled dogma? Is it a religion? This is nonsense. So, but they really feel, I'm telling you, very intelligent otherwise people, well, they bought it so severely. It's their religion. They want religion. And the fact is, they are now expressing their belief in climate change from a religious, faith-based standpoint. This is their new religion. It's the earth is their religion. Who wants the earth? I don't want the earth. It's ridiculous. I don't, a body living in the earth, trying to breathe, this is complete nonsense. I don't have any strong attachment to the world. I mean, it's okay. I'm honoring our creativity from that standpoint. You know, I'm not going to attack the world or do anything about it. But certainly it's not my religion. That's ridiculous. So they truly believe that you're completely insane if you don't accept their dogma, their religious, their new world order, new religion. So we're not going to stand for that. We're not going to stay here and be bullied in that way. And we don't want to spend our time standing up to bullies. Well, why should we spend our time that way? That's ridiculous again. I have better things to do than just continually fend off, you know, bullying. I have, you know, glory of eternal life awaits. I'm not going to waste my time standing up to bullying. Let the bullies sing a different tune and repent, and then we'll see what we can do. And I'm not going to spend my time fending off a marketing campaign, you know, designed to attract and allure, you know, lure us into this new religion. I have better things to do than waste my time that way. Again, it's ridiculous to think that we are going to spend or should spend our time that way. I mean, it's I have no interest in the New World religion. No interest in it. It's the ego's religion. So we have to start standing up for ourselves here and declaring, hey, you know, what's good for the goose is good for the gander. And we're going to take the necessary steps to, you know, for our happiness, and go in the direction where we believe our happiness is, not in the direction where they're dictating to us, telling us where our happiness has to be found through worshiping Mother Earth and, you know, climate change and all this dogma. We don't have to go along with that. They can brand us, you know, terrorists, heretics, you know, all this kind of nonsense. This is just, it means nothing. It means nothing. God is perfectly still and quiet and calm and peaceful and not reacting to anything. So we know that. It's not like, well, we got to do something in order to prevent God from reacting. This is utter nonsense. God does not react. There's nothing anyone needs to do for God to be God, God for God to be totally non-reactive and peaceful. Nothing anyone has to do or not do. So we're just getting our wings here is what we're really doing. We're just starting to flap our wings and realizing, hey, I can flap my wings. I'm not going to be bullied and paralyzed and told I can't flap my wings and start, you know, and learn how to really fly spiritually. No. Nobody's going to, and I'm not going to waste my time fending off pressure, you know, not to fly. What a waste of time. It serves no purpose. Now, I came across something on the internet by chance. It was checking in on the one of the pages that I go to. There's an advertisement there. And I said, "What is this?" And I checked on it just to see what is this. It seemed to be very spiritual and intriguing, but it was amazing. It's the same old, same old, same old. Here is this someone saying, "I'm an enlightened being. You know, I'm super advanced, enlightened being, graced by these gurus, blah, and come to my workshops, and in just one weekend workshop, you're going to be enlightened. I now have the technology and can give this, you know, give this presence which will enlighten you, and you will realize your true self, and you'll be enlightened." And he says, "Oh yeah, it'll work for everybody. Come on, you know, more of the same. Okay, this is so ridiculous. There's an old saying, catch a fish for someone, you feed him for one meal. Teach him how to fish, you feed him for a lifetime. So what we're doing here is teaching us how to fish. Which means, how do you manage the success on your spiritual path? That's, you have to attain the tools so you can work with your path every day. Without those tools, you're going to be then vulnerable to these people. Say, "Oh yeah, come to my retreat, weekend retreat." You'll be enlightened. Now, there's another very interesting fact that we need to bring to light. And keep in mind, as I always say, I'm speaking from the standpoint of spirit, eternal mind, speaking to eternal mind here. Okay, so we can talk about the trickery of the ego. And I've said that what the ego does is it flatters the female aspect of this dream of death and saying, "Look, you know, the reason why, you know, men don't do what you tell them to do is they're jealous of you, that you're really spiritually superior to men. And how could you say such a thing? The only way you could say such a thing is if females don't have a continuity problem and men do. Because otherwise we realize we're just eternal mind, eternal life. There wouldn't be any way to say something's greater or lesser. So the only way you can say that is you're really tacitly saying that women don't have a continuity problem, men do. And so the ego flatters women saying, "Guess what? You're really fortunate that you're a woman. You don't have a continuity problem. It's the men that have a continuity problem. That's a terrible, messy, horrible problem, like a plumbing problem, you know, the car problem. You know, let the men take care of this terrible, horrible work that, you know, building the roads and the bridges and repairing, building this, repairing that, all this, you know, terrible stuff. You know, they're born slaves. You know, and all the spiritual effort they're putting into the path of, you know, a lifetime of effort. Nonsense," the ego says. "You don't need to do that. You don't have a continuity problem. You're superior." So some women have bought into this. Now, if they don't have a continuity problem, then they should be able to be enlightened in a weekend retreat, right? So what do you see in modern spirituality? I've been saying this over and over again. About 90% of the people involved are women in this New Age stuff. It's extraordinarily dominated by women. And it all of this New Age stuff is fast food spirituality, trying to spiritualize mortal mind, saying, "We have a way that you can just get it real easy." And the women say, "Well, of course I can get it easy. I don't really have a continuity problem at all. I should just be able to go to the teacher and just one meeting like that and I'm enlightened." I mean, right? That's egoic logic, isn't it? If I don't have a continuity problem, enlightenment should be instantaneous for me. I shouldn't have any problem. All I have to just do is, you know, go see a teacher. They'll say, "Yeah, you're enlightened." And say, "Okay, I'm enlightened. It should be easy." Where, like, from my standpoint, I look at the teacher saying that, I said, "What an idiot. You know, they have all these, this resume of all these great teachers they've been with and all these practices and all blah, 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 and study for this so long and got a degree in this and this. And, you know, and I say, what an idiot, you know. He's not teaching anyone how to fish. He's not teaching how to manage your success, the tools you need, the full stop and the wow, you know, the great discipline, telling you, hey, it's going to take a lifetime probably of tremendous effort. You know, just so of course, from my standpoint, I understand the severity of the continuity problem. I realize this is nonsense. Go to a weekend retreat and be enlightened. Utter nonsense. And yet the women just flock to these type of teachers because they're reinforcing the belief that women don't have a continuity problem. That they're superior to men, that they deserve to rule over this realm. And men, their natural place of men is to be their slaves and do all the nasty, terrible, difficult work and buy, you know, get all the money so they can live a very wonderful life. Someone just told me, you know, his wife, you know, he says, my wife, she looks so young because there's no stress, nothing that she needs to do. She just lives a, you know, pampered life and just... You know, I just work, and, you know, it's just, you know, what does she do? Where's the stress? Where's the difficulty? No, taking it easy. Now, this, of course, is not true in many cases. I'm just showing you what's going on here. So don't anyone out take it personally out there. This is not a personal, something I'm saying personally. I'm saying the bigger picture of this world culture, okay, and why do so many women flock to these teachers who do not teach how to manage your success, but rather they say, I can give you enlightenment. I'm the enlightened guru. I give you enlightenment. Because the ego has convinced them they don't have a continuity problem. Or it's almost non-existent, virtually non-existent. So from my standpoint, I don't have any use for those kind of teachers at all. Because I know that the continuity fear is so extreme. Remember, the continuity fear, really, to boil it down, is we feel we'll be completely without any function. If we stop pretending, we'll be without any function. Now, remember, the problem is not pretending to be a woman or pretending to be a man. It's pretending itself that's the problem. It doesn't matter what you pretend. It's the habit of pretending that's the problem. So it's totally immaterial whether you're pretending to be a woman or a man or whatever else. It's the fact that you're pretending, and we're trying to believe that we have become what we are pretending. And therefore, if we stop pretending, we'll lose our identity. So we're terrified of to stop pretending, which we need to do to realize we're eternal life. We have to stop pretending, of course. Well, we can take an intermediate step of pretending to be eternal life, quote unquote, by honoring our creativity, saying I'm both eternal life and not eternal life. That's this thin intermediate step. I mean, we absolutely can take this if we understand this. But it's pretending itself that's the problem. And so we have to be very careful as we, you know, as we work towards to let go of pretending. We're very jittery about it, actually. The lack of truly enlightened beings in this world is testimony to it, how extraordinarily difficult it is. You have all sorts of people who've gotten a glimpse of eternal life and then have, you know, built up an image of it, so to speak, but those who are actually abiding in it is very rare. It's the abidance in it which is important, which that is what is truly important. And this is what we're struggling with. This is why we're working so hard here, because the goal is abidance in it. It is not merely glimpsing it. That is not at all sufficient. And in order to do this, you have to learn the tools to manage your success, because as you go along, you'll get closer and closer and closer to abidance, and you'll get more and more nervous. The fear becomes, you know, very tough. You have to know how to stay poised, how to handle this extreme difficulty. And of course, most women will say, well, if it's that difficult, let men take care of it. I'm not going to bother with that. I don't have to bother with that. That's not my role or something, which is nonsense, because it's eternal mind pretending to not be eternal mind. That's the problem. And so nobody can do it for somebody else at all. Because each one of us has to give up our pretense, our pretending, for ourselves. We can't do it for someone else. So the real teaching is to teach the tools. You know, teach someone how to use tools and they can build infinite houses, right? Or buildings, once they know how to learn all the tools. Build a house for them, maybe they can live in it for a little while. But teach them how to build and they can build anything. Well, so a spiritual path, learn the tools of how to manage success, and nobody can stop you then. No one can stop you. Because ultimately, we only stop ourselves. And if we can manage our progress on the path, then we won't stop ourselves. We will succeed. So it's very tough to teach in this world right now. I don't know how it can possibly go, because what men and women want here is that women want to be just simply affirmed that they're superior, spiritually superior men, and they just want the evidence of that. And the men also want to believe that spirit women are greater than them, because they're the women who are managing now this new world religion of the goddess worship, earth worship, planet worship, body worship, all this stuff. And they think that, well, this protects them from, you know, stopping their pretending. So they want to stay attracted to all of this, and women provide this attractiveness. So they want to believe in it too. So everybody here really wants to go along with this, you know, new world religion, which is just a delaying tactic. And they want to avoid the tough work. That's all. They want to avoid it. And they think that if they just wait long enough, they'll end up being the new prime creator. This is the final end game of it all. It doesn't work at all. It will never work. So, you know, at some point you have to let them experience the thorn in the flesh and stop pampering everyone. Realize you let them suffer, from their arrogance and their belief. And unfortunately, you know, it falls on the head of men, usually, that, you know, they're forced to fight the wars and do the dirty work and all this stuff. And then, but you know, that's to their benefit too, because ultimately they'll say, hey, I don't want to keep doing this. What's the truth really here? And so they end up being the ones that get, you know, decide, hey, I'm used to doing really hard work. Let me keep doing that. And this is just a general statement. Of course, there's some women also, especially the ones who find, you know, a lot of pressure on them. Those are the blessed ones, you know, who get with it and say, hey, I can't rely on men to solve all my this continuity problem for me. I've got to get after it myself here. So those are the blessed ones, really, the ones who are truly blessed. The princesses, they're not blessed at all. Who wants to be a princess? That's the worst position possible in this world. Habits die high, die hard. They die hard. It's very difficult. The temptation is enormous to use attraction to try to get somebody else to do the work for you. But if you learn the tools, you gain more and more confidence. Hey, I can make it. I can make it. I just have to apply these tools. I mean, if you learn how to use a saw, you can cut any piece of lumber, right? Even big beams, you get a beam saw, you can just cut right through it. You can fashion any piece of lumber any way you want to, actually. So once you learn these skills, you know, whatever arises, you can continue on. So it's developing the skill set that's important. And this does not happen overnight by any means. It's a lifelong skill, lifelong situation where you develop the skill set and you apply it and keep applying it and keep applying it, get better and better and better and better at it. It's the toughest management job there is. Nothing is as tough. And nobody can do it for you. And if people give up, it's because they haven't developed the skill set. They haven't really applied themselves to, you know, how do I keep going every day? How I can't stall out. Why am I stalling out? The wow is too severe. I gave up on it. I didn't give it time. I didn't allow it. I started to defend and struggle with it, and et cetera, et cetera. And so, it used to be, of course, in this world where people who took the spiritual path, it was understood it's a lifelong path, for sure. Nowadays, you never hear that, or almost never hear that. It's anyone who says that they're treated like they're idiots. It's kind of like, well, you just get a smartphone and you're now smart, and you do it in a weekend retreat. If you don't, there's something the matter with you. They say, well, we've advanced in all other ways. We should advance in this way. There's no way to advance out of the continuity problem. And this should be obvious to us. Because, again, the continuity problem is that we have been pretending for so long, so intently, so creatively, pretending to be something that we're not, something other than what we are, that if we stop pretending entirely, just stop this pretending, we'll cease to exist. We'll have no functionality and therefore don't exist. So there's a dreadful fear. So what people are doing, they're just pretending to be spiritual, pretending to be spiritual. But that's a little different than pretending to be eternal life. It's not the same. So they keep on pretending. They keep on pretending. And label it this way, and label it this way, and label it this way. They don't really get into the fear of it and look at it and see it. Let reason look at it. You have to open it up to the light of reason and just recognize and say, hey, wait a minute. The ego's logic is completely flawed here. Hey, wait a minute. This is totally wrong. Hey, this is ridiculous. And you can see, logically, we built this massive defensive system of false logic that we can see through it. We can see through it. We can. The reason within us, the Holy Spirit is really the reason within us. The voice of reason within us. We look at it and say, oh my gosh, this is, you know, completely false. This is absolutely not true. And gradually we break through these taboos, these fears. And gradually we evaporate the continuity fear. But it is Jesus says it's a very difficult process. You go through different stages and plateaus and stuff, and it's quite difficult. You don't always get it in one lifetime. It's possible you certainly can. So people should not come to and teacher for enlightenment. They should come to learn the tools of managing their path. This is what they really should be looking for in any religion, any teacher. What tools are you giving me to manage my path? Now, I try to stay objective about everything. And the Catholic Church, for example, has certainly tried to do this in certain ways. They do try. So they're to be commended in that way. Just because the Pope is Antichrist, is part of the two-headed Antichrist, doesn't mean that the Catholic Church is all bad, not by any means. The fact that they have, there's confusion and pagan confusion and all that, that doesn't mean it's all bad. They have tried. They do say it's a lifelong commitment. They do give tools to try to help you manage your path. Absolutely. I mean, so there's some positivity there. Absolutely there is. And the idea in this world is you're born into religion, or you choose a religion, and it's going to be a lifelong commitment. This is how it should be. A lifelong commitment to manage the success on your path. And so, but you know, we have to ultimately do better. It needs to be clear. The overall picture of the situation needs to be clear. The theology and the Christology and all the stuff, the church is just a mess. It's just a mess. And but yet still, people can make progress. We can make progress in the world, whatever religion that we're really in. We can make progress. But oftentimes, ultimate success seems to be denied us because of a lot of confusion there. But managing the tools to manage your path, this is what you should be aiming for. And also help in practicing, you know, encouragement to practice. We have the three-stage practice, three phases of assertions. Full stop on the wow, flipping the script. This is super important. This is a tool to learn this practice. Then you have this tool that wherever you are in your life, whatever the circumstances may be, you say, you know what? Nobody can stop me from practicing no matter what's going on. I can still practice. And I know how to practice, and I know how to successfully practice. And I know how to continue my momentum. I know how to go deeper and deeper into inquiry. Like Ramana Maharshi says, nobody succeeds except through, you know, great determination, great perseverance, determination. Nobody is going to succeed. Whoever succeeds has done it through great perseverance, great determination. This is the gist of what he says. This is a fact. Great determination, great perseverance. You don't go to a weekend retreat and get enlightened. This is nonsense. This is catering to the New World religion. It's catering to where the money is, where women say, hey, someone is, you know, flattering me here. Yeah, I think I'll go for that. I can come, I can get in touch with, say, oh yeah, you're naturally the heart center, so just get in touch with your heart center and feel loving towards the world, and you're enlightened. This is it. You got it. What is that? That's not the goal. The goal is to realize we are eternal life. We've never been bodies. And abiding in this realization. And it's not easy. It seems to be an enormous struggle and difficulty for anyone. The lack of success is testimony to this. There's so many who can talk spiritually. How many are actually abiding in non-dual presence of God, in the true presence of God? How many are actually just continuously abiding in that? Very rare. Because we don't learn the tools of our trade, the tools of managing our success on the path to enlightenment. You will meet tremendous success as you go along, and tremendous realization you're getting closer, and tremendous glimpsing of the goal, and it's just your whole set of expectations are continuously being reshuffled. You're continuously dealing with a tremendous elation of realizing how close I'm getting. This is really working. This is extraordinarily difficult to. Your entire identity is constantly being rearranged. And then what am I going to do with this? How am I going to function? What's my functionality? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it's very tough, very stressful. But is made much less so by having the right tools, the tactics, the right tactics to use. And it's about being very wise. And we're living in a world of lunatics, and they're pursuing their agenda very severely, which is to pull us, you know, into ignoring that we have a continuity problem, not working on it at all, thinking that if we don't work on it, it must not be there. Therefore, hey, we're free, you know, we're enlightened. There isn't any continuity problem. You know, it's easy to just say, well, I've never been born, blah, 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 blah. But we still have a continuity problem because we've been pretending that we've been born for so long that to drop the pretending is so difficult. There's so much fear involved with this. So anybody can talk a good spiritual game. But we're not, you know, we're both doing that and emphasizing the skills, the tools of the trade, that's the major emphasis here, clearly. And we also talk a good spiritual game too, but the major emphasis is on the tools and using these tools and how difficult it is, how you, every day you have to keep working at it. I've never had a day off in this. Never taken a day off. Not that if you take a day off it ruins you at all. It just slows you down. I realize that it slows you down. So why do it? You have to look at glasses half full. Don't worry. And you have to, you know, don't get hooked in by the marketing campaigns of the world. There's going to be, I believe, an unprecedented marketing campaign over the next 9+ months. And we have to be ready for this. And, you know, I've been trying, what can I do to offset this? I've been trying to work with graphics, beautiful graphics of Ron Maharshi. I posted all these individual pictures that I've done on my blog, Jesus Postcards dot, was it blogspot? The link's here on the description of this video. The link is there. It's always there. How to help offset this marketing campaign that's going to come about. This is the issue. I tried to use, you know, like female enlightened, those who've been enlightened and happen to be in a female form. But I found that this actually encourages the arrogance of women here, thinking that, oh, look, you see, this teacher is enlightened. That just shows that I really don't have a continuity problem. That really is natural to me. I really don't have to work at it. You know, it just seems to encourage that. It seems to make things worse, unfortunately. That's what I've seen. Is that it helps them believe that, oh, yeah, we're naturally spiritually superior. It feeds their spiritual neurosis. They have a very severe spiritual neurosis, as a way of putting it, very severe. Thinking that it's all, you know, men's fault. And if men are just enslaved, everything will be fine. This is the severe neurosis of the times. And so, you know, I don't want to feed that, unfortunately. I'd love to present great, you know, examples of enlightened women, the eternal mind appearing here, eternal life appearing here with a female form. It has happened, but this feeds the neurosis of the times way too severely. So I'm just desperately struggling, knowing that this campaign is going to come. It's already been going on for the last 60 years, actually. This glamour and attraction and you know, women marketing the new world religion, in which the new world religion states that women are spiritually superior to men, and women don't have a continuity problem. And women think, oh, as soon as that new religion's in place, everyone agrees with it, we're free, we're happy, everything's solved. You know, the myth of a continuity issue will be gone. We won't even have to worry about it. And of course, all they've done is enmesh themselves in extreme, you know, egotistical arrogance and self-delusion. They have an extreme continuity problem, as does everyone here. the fear of, to stop pretending to be something that they're not. The very fact they say, well, us women, we don't have a condom problem, that means they're pretending to be women. It means they're pretending to be a body, pretending to be a body mind, pretending to be a form, pretending to be in time, space, process, and form, pretending to be in a world, pretending, you know, all this stuff means they have a severely pretending. So of course, anyone who pretends is going to have a continuity problem. There's no question about it. Our creativity is such when we pretend to be something we're not, we're afraid to stop pretending. We're so convinced that we actually are that what we're pretending to be. we think we won't have any function, you know. So we think pretending is causative of a new being. It's not. It's not causative. We cannot pretend to be something else and then have created that something else. No, we did not create our own identity. Our identity is created by God, and that's what we are. We can't change our identity by pretending to be something else. It's not possible. So what to do to help out as this marketing campaign is going to become ferocious in my what the Holy Spirit has shown me. And it causes me to be very nervous because I know everyone is susceptible to it on this planet. This is how ferocious it will be. Very diabolical, very clever. And you will see that women will press their advantage now. Because they desperately want this new world religion, because they have not taken up the challenge of dissipating the continuity fear, and they feel this is the only way to go, and so, you know, they're desperate to bring about this new world religion, so they will employ desperate measures, to say the least. And this has already been going on for the last 60 years or so, even a little longer than that, but very severe. By hook or by crook, they want this new world religion where they're given basically free pass. Oh, guess what? We've just decreed you don't have a continuity problem. Bingo, see? So therefore it doesn't exist. It doesn't work that way. It'll never work that way. It's just making things worse. So how to insulate ourselves from this extreme marketing campaign is really an essential. You know, it's essential we look at this. And I'm shocked. I did this video of Ram Maharshi, and it's a beautiful video. Ram Maharshi, Silence is also Conversation. It's just extraordinary, you know. And the views have been 33 views. I mean, I'm really shocked. Ram Maharshi is very popular, has been. And I guess one of my videos on Ram Maharshi, Advice of Ram Maharshi, has got like, I don't know how many views, like almost 200,000 views or something. It's just unbelievable. Yet, at this point right now, this video is just like, gone nowhere. And it's like, wow, very interesting. Very, very interesting. It shows a real change is taking place here. It's not strong enough right now. Graphics are not strong enough to help people. This is the Holy Spirit pointed this out to me, that graphics are not strong enough. I mean, I can do a fabulous job on graphics. I've spent, you know, a lifetime being artistic with graphics. If I really worked at it, I mean, I can do some, you know, extraordinarily beautiful graphics. But the Holy Spirit says it doesn't work anymore. It's not strong enough. And, you know, I accept this. You know, I understand that the Holy Spirit's right. And what the Holy Spirit has told me is you have to sidestep the situation somehow. Well, how do we do that? In other words, instead of, you know, trying to combat this campaign that's going to happen, it's going to be so severe, instead of trying to stand up to it and say, well, I got something, you know, better. Here's a graphic. We need to just avoid being impacted by this altogether. Don't allow ourselves to be subjected to this marketing campaign. That's how severe it is. And again, the Bible points this out very clearly, that even the elect of God, those who have elected for eternal life, are in danger of dropping that and succumbing to this campaign that is going to be waged. It's a war, actually, for the mind, for belief. It's a war. It's a severe marketing campaign, marketing the new world religion, using a lot of factors. Climate change dogma is certainly at the heart of this, but there's many, many, many factors, and you'll see many, many spiritual teachers actually being part of this marketing campaign, those who've claimed to be spiritual teachers. It's amazing. If you don't agree with this dogma, you know, the new world religion dogma, it's like they say, people say, well, you're not spiritual, you got a problem, you know, what's the matter with you? Here, let me help you. You know, this nonsense. If you're not, you know, clearly a progressive, you know, and believing in all this dogma of the new world order, new world religion, they say, you know, let me help you, you got a problem. It's ridiculous. These aren't really teachers. These are not true teachers at all. So there'll be a lot of spiritual, I rarely ever hear a spiritual teacher, I don't know if I've ever come across one, that rejects the dogma of the progressives, the liberal progressives, which is really those who are marketing this, you know, new world religion. I don't know if I've ever heard one reject it. Because their bread and butter is these women who come to them. 90% are women. 70-90%. They pay their bills. And to reject this, they would leave. They would lose their audience, their money, their crowd, their, you know, all of that. So they're catering to them, absolutely catering and flattering these women by telling them that they don't have a continuity problem. But I refuse to do that here. I'm doing, you know, the greatest service possible to quote-unquote women, which is really spirit pretending to be women, by telling them you absolutely have a severe continuity problem. And you have to learn the tools of the path. And it's this that will free you from this continuity problem, and not any new world religion that flatters you. Flattery is the worst thing possible. Stay away from it. Stay away from those who flatter your ego by saying how spiritual you are, naturally this, you don't need to work so hard. This is all flattery. Stay away from flattery. You have to be very dedicated and apply the tools. Learn your craft and of the spiritual path and become an expert at it. Manage your success. You must be an expert manager of your success on the and dropping pretending altogether. And it's very, very, it takes great discipline and perseverance. So this is true compassion, true love is telling people the truth of you know what they have to do instead of flattering them. And we got so many flatterers around, it's ridiculous. So, and we'll be shocked, you know, to find out that these teachers we think are these big important teachers are now, you know, they're part of this whole new world religion thing of let's spiritualize the world, make this great planet together, we can bring love and harmony here, not unless you get free of the continuity fear. When you get free of the continuity fear, you realize there isn't any world. I'm not a person. There none of us are. We're all completely formless, you know, spirit. What do we need a world for? It's ridiculous. You're not going to spend your time trying to spiritualize the world. The great teachers didn't do that. They spent their time making sure that those who were, they were helping gain these tools of the spiritual path, how to manage their success. That's what they spent their time on. You know, the great teachers, they often don't do anything, just sit silently or very little, anything. But they do say every day you must practice and go and do better than yesterday. Go big, I say, go big today. You must go big today. This is what I try to live by. I must do better today than what I did yesterday. I must be, you know, go further today. Challenge myself and use the tools of full stop and the wow. Challenge yourself every day to go further. This is the right way. So when I finish this video, what am I going to do? I'm going to say, well, I've got to do better somehow. How can I go do better? I mean, graphics don't seem to work. I mean, I can make more beautiful graphics, but they're not going to work. Because this marketing campaign will sweep all that away. We'll sweep it all away. It'll be that ferocious. So as I said, a gathering storm is coming, and it may be this marketing campaign. I don't necessarily say it's a war. I just say there's going to be ferocious pressure put on us to buy into this new world religion. Whereas the president and the pope will agree, you know, they say we're both on the same page. We both agree there's going to be a great combination of science and religion now in the world. We're both all going to agree that this is really the problem, you know. The president, the mortician of the United States has come out and saying that the greatest problem we have in the world is climate change. This is it. This is the greatest issue of our time and of all times. We have an historic issue to face here. And the Pope, same thing, historic issue. This is all important. And so they will, you know, this will be pushed, and they will, and this president is exceptionally adept at getting his way. Exceptionally adept at it. He manages by hook or by crook to bully his way forward and get what he wants. And this Pope is extremely popular around the world. The same thing, they're going to use their popularity, their spiritual, you know, not their political techniques. And keep in mind that politicians know how to push something through that people don't want, some vicious laws, by burying it in a very popular bill. So they're using climate change as this front. It's a front. Okay, they're using it as a front. This is the problem. I'm not saying that humans are not causing issues. Of course, they're causing some issues, right? But the climate change is being used politically as a political front to then smuggle through under the skirts of this issue of climate change, to smuggle through a massive amount of totalitarian dictatorial laws. And that's the real purpose that they're using it for. Okay, so this is what we're objecting to and pointing out here. I'm not a climate change denier, so to speak. I'm saying that this issue is being used for political purposes, just like in politics. If somebody, a senator, wants a bill, you know, they want to get through a pork barrel bill, and they say, "Well, I'll vote for your bill," and really it's something that everybody will vote for if you attach this to your bill. And so once it gets attached to it, the people say, "Well, I'm not going to vote this popular bill down just because it's got this pork barrel thing attached to it. What the heck? Let's just pass it and forget about it." This is politics. So they're using this popular climate change thing as a front to basically smuggle in this totalitarian New World Order, cosmic corporate culture, which is going to incorporate this planet into very, very, very nasty situation. This is what we're saying. So in no way do we agree with such a situation. No, in no way is that agreeable to us. Absolutely not. And so we do not want to be targeted by this marketing campaign. It's going to be, it'll crush anybody. You know, I myself think that it could crush me, okay? Absolutely, it's going to be that severe. It will come at you from all angles, in your family, in your church, everywhere you go. You're going to just be inundated by pressure and by all sorts of allurement and attractions. And say, someone will say, "Hey, I'll give you a position, you know, at the university, or a tenure, you know, job, or, you know, group money, whatever inducement." They say, "Look, we're all in this together. We got to pull together, and I think you're really valuable, really helpful. So, you know, you're gonna have an audience and a job and money and everything, but you just have to go along with this, you know, agenda. It's easy, you know, it's not difficult. Nobody could be against it. How could they?" Well, we're against smuggling in this totalitarian regime into under the skirts of this front. You know, it's like using this beautiful woman, and under her skirts you're smuggling in all these, you know, all this vermin, you know, because they said, "You can't possibly be against this beautiful lady, can you? Oh, that's ridiculous. She just wants to come into your house and say hello to you. You know, who could be against that?" Yeah, but as she moves, you know, she has this long skirt. As she moves, all the vermin is coming with her into your house. And then they, under the shadows, oh, the lights went up. All the vermin scatters into your house. And the termites, the cockroaches, the plagues of every kind, you know, all this terrible nastiness is into your house now. So we're absolutely against this so-called goddess coming into our house, who's smuggling in this vermin and these plagues into our house. That's a no-brainer. When you look at it in the right way, it's a no-brainer. Of course, we're against it. Nobody could be for that if they knew what's going on. So as we're seeing the severity of it, the Holy Spirit wants me to see the severity of what's coming, just how heavy it is. And to not think, "Oh, you know, you'll be able to handle that." I remember when the Holy Spirit said, "Stop watching television." I said, "No, I can handle it." The Holy Spirit says, "No, you can't. No, you can't. You've got to stop. or you'll be lost to me, to the voice of reason. And I said, oh, okay. And I stopped. I absolutely stopped. I said, you know better than I do. But I thought I could handle it. Well, the same situation now, so, you know, I might think, well, I should be able to handle this. I'm an expert and all this. Holy Spirit is saying, no. No, this is a good time to sidestep, okay? This is a good time to practice humility. It's the best time possible to practice humility. If you have any remaining pride, you know, it's a good time to practice humility now. Listen to the Holy Spirit. So we're getting closer and closer and closer to finding out something here as we're accepting, wow. Okay, now we understand what's going on. This new world religion, new world order, is going to market itself very aggressively. It'd be the most aggressive marketing campaign in history. Nothing even comes close to it. There'll be severe pressures put on us economically. Our very survival will be, you know, they will be moving quickly towards labeling you as a global terrorist if you don't support this new world order, new world religion, because they'll call you an eco-terrorist or something. You're not supportive of it. You know, you will be persona non grata everywhere in this world, and on and on and on and on and on. So the pressures will just be, you know, extraordinary. And so why even subject ourselves to this? It's folly. We don't want to. You know, why be trying to be a hero? You're just subjecting yourself to being, you know, massive bombardment. That's not fun at all, really. I don't, you know. So I mean, just from that standpoint, I want to be happy. I don't want to be dodging all this bombardment. That's ridiculous. So if someone does that, I would just say it's ridiculous. Why don't you just be happy instead and sidestep it? It's not going to make you any better than us, you know, hanging in there and fighting against it. It doesn't make you any better. You're still eternal life, just like we are. But meanwhile, you spend all this time in misery, you know, trying to fend all this stuff off. And forget it. You're certainly not going to convince the people of this world to forego their new world order, new world religion. Certainly you're not going to convince them. They're all in because they feel that, you know, they having not acquired any skills on to manage their spiritual success and in evaporating the continuity fear, they feel this is the only way that there is, the only option they have. So in the short term, I don't think anyone is going to be persuaded at this point. People have really locked in to a mindset. And they will, you know, they'll have to play it out and see how it plays out and see, you know, what kind of misery it brings them before they may repent and decide, you know what, this isn't what I thought it was going to be. And everyone reaches that point eventually. This isn't what I thought it was going to be. And so, and of course, the ego's logic says, well, once we get the right people in the right places, the right religion, etc., then they'll just be able to, you know, enlighten you just at a touch. Oh, okay, I decree that you're now enlightened. You know, the women have no continuity fear naturally. You'll get them to the position of the goddess, and you'll be able to go to them, and they'll just be able to just decree like a Vestal Virgin. I mean, it's basically the religion of the Vestal Virgins all over again, where if the Vestal Virgin simply decrees, I want this one to be enlightened, then you are, by decree, enlightened. See, and everyone thinks, well, wow, what a great religion. All I got to do is get on the right side of the Vestal Virgins, and I will be liberated. I'll be free. Of course, this is just complete self-deception. Because you have to drop, in order to be free, you have to stop all pretending. You know, you drop basically all pretending. You can pretend in a certain way, you can pretend to be eternal life. And you're still honoring your creativity of a world and all this, but you say, yes, I'm both eternal life and not eternal life. But, you know, just for the sake of talking here, we'll say you have to give up all pretending. And if you don't do that, you're still completely deluded, still pretending. The strain of pretending, the fear of pretending. Doesn't matter what a Vestal Virgin says. It makes no difference whatsoever. It has nothing to do with anything. What a tricky religion, huh? Even the guys have bought into this now, saying, hey, if I just, you know, have this wife treat my wife like a Vestal Virgin, all she has to do is then just bestow enlightenment upon me. Just say, oh yeah, okay, you're a good guy. I like you. You've been good to me. So you're enlightened now through decree. And the guy says, oh, how easy is that, you see? Of course, it's not so easy because it doesn't work. And, you know, the Vestal Virgin will decree and it doesn't work. And she'll say, well, you know, it didn't work because you just didn't honor me enough. So if you honor me even more, then it will really work. You know, and it goes endless. It's an endless trap, isn't it, that thing, that way. There's always an out. The goddess always has an excuse. The ego always has an excuse. Well, you just didn't honor me enough. That's why it didn't work. Come back later when you're willing to really honor me. And then it will really work for you. And that just can go on forever, right? I mean, it's just a dead end. It's an inherent dead end. So, again, my focus has always been on sidestepping this marketing campaign. Always the Holy Spirit has told me, this is really what's important. Don't subject yourself to it. But how is this possible? I'm thinking, well, when you were really focused on this and accepting of it, then maybe the Holy Spirit will be able to put the idea into our minds and we'll accept it. Say, oh, maybe we can do this? Yeah. Oh, wow. Okay. It's like planet Earth is undergoing this unprecedentedly ferocious marketing campaign of dead-end, false, egoic, Vestal Virgin Goddess nonsense path. Well, of course we're going to sidestep this. Now, I did have this dream years ago where this drastic collapse happened on this planet. Everybody was buried in dust. The atmosphere was so dusty. It was horrible. And I fled it. I successfully fled it. And I ended up in this other place. And I said, I was, living here. I was staying in this one place, but this terrible catastrophe happened and I had to flee it. And I'm wondering if you'd honor my reservations there, here. Is that possible? And they said, of course. In fact, we were expecting you. We understand this problem happened. And we're absolutely delighted you're here. And our house is your house. Our place is your place. Just enjoy. And so I said, wow, thank you very much. And I went around looking. I said, my gosh, this place is vastly superior to where I came from. So the fact that we're fleeing this extreme oppression in the world, do you not think that there's places that are aware of this, that during this time on planet Earth there's this extraordinary oppression taking place, and we're spiritual refugees asking for refugee status, and they're happy to grant that to us. They'd say, well, we've prepared for you, we understand, and we're absolutely delighted that you're taking refuge from this. Of course this is very likely. This is unprecedented suppression and oppression on this planet, this marketing campaign, this severe oppression taking place here. And the wisdom will inform those that we need to sidestep this. We need to avoid the impact on us to preserve our own momentum towards eternal life. So certainly we don't want to subject ourselves to this. And the wise would certainly be aware, of course you don't want to, of course you want to sidestep this. So I'm sure there's some mechanism, some situation that'll enable us to sidestep this. There has to be. But we just have to be to see it, that this is, on planet Earth, this is an extraordinary oppression taking place, an extraordinary marketing campaign to pull us into delusion. Egoic delusion. And we have every right to sidestep this, to ask for help in this. Every right. And if we were to take a bigger perspective of other dimensions, other areas in the universe or whatever, that maybe they'd be looking at this and saying, my God, this is hideous here. And why don't these people ask for sanctuary? My God, what are they doing? Why are they subjecting themselves to this? We're happy to, grant them sanctuary, and then yet they're not even asking for it, Yeah, that's crazy. And I'm sure they feel very sad for us, and what a pity this is taking place here. So It is absolutely justified. And you can say, of course I took sanctuary during this hideous time of 215, 216, in this hideous time, the dark times of oppression in this world, that I fled those dark ages there. And thankful that I did, very thankful that I was given sanctuary. And those that gave me sanctuary, they're very thankful they did too, because they then enabled us to accept, you know, continue on towards accepting eternal mind and succeed at it, which will then greatly bless their situation, you know, greatly bless everyone. So it's a win-win-win-win-win-win-win situation. So, I mean, it is folly not to take sanctuary, absolute folly. And so, you know, it's like a plague, you know, a hideous plague. Of course you're going to want to flee that plague. Reason would support you 100% in doing this. So we're trying to get into this mindset, this new mindset here. And nobody's too infirm to flee it. You can cast off infirmity, actually. If you really wanted to flee it, you could cast off age, you could cast off infirmity. That's just being used to try and keep you here. So then you're subjected to this marketing campaign. The true believers think everybody should be subjected to it. That this is the measure of how righteous it is. The measure of how righteous it is. Jesus says, God did not create worlds or universes or bodies or anything like this. This is ridiculous to think that we're a body in a world and this is our destiny. This is what God wants for us. This is our destiny. But since on our creativity, we don't have to become formless right this moment. We can go to another world that's more receptive to spiritual practice. It's not like God says you can't make worlds or universes or anything. We're free to do whatever we want to do. But so, you know, we don't have to just become, you know, formless like that. No, we don't need to do that. But we certainly need to sidestep an extraordinarily vicious, plague-ridden tribulation marketing campaign designed to pull you into a false religion. Of course you should have the facility to sidestep that. And of course we have parallel lives on many planets and many places, other dimensions, etc. Why don't just let one of those parallel lives just invite us to live with them? It's family, isn't it? Not family. I mean, it's our own self. We're imagining many lives in many different places simultaneously. So why can't our other lives help us out? This was touched upon in the Seth material, but Jane Roberts talking about, you know, we have many lives simultaneously, and Jesus also mentions it in Journey Beyond Words, that actually we have the easy capacity. He didn't insist we're doing it, but he says we can easily and certainly, well, he says all lives are being lived simultaneously ultimately, but we can imagine ourselves many, many, many lives in many, many different places, even different universes, etc. So why don't we say, hey, other life, I'm asking, can I like to come and stay with you for a while. I know, you know, I'm a bit ragged, but I'm also, you know, pretty good at managing the spiritual path. So, you know, help me out. Why wouldn't they do that? They'd be honored to do that, actually. Be honored to do that. We think that people in different places are some kind of complete aliens, you know. No, they're just our own lives, parallel lives that we're imagining in different dimensions, different places, all sorts of. So absolutely, or ultimately we're all one anyway, so why can't we invite ourselves? we can. Now, I brought up a previous life that I had. Very important to realize we do have these previous lives. Now, we see it in a linear fashion here, but I brought this life, this previous life, back to life, as it were, and I've been saying it's simultaneous. This previous life is very pleased at what I'm doing right now and is aware of it, so to speak, and these all lives are really timeless lives. So why can't we get an invitation from a quote-unquote a future life. See, by bringing back this previous life of my own, I'm like a future life to that previous life, but I'm saying, no, you're parallel with me. Come here and watch the parade with me. You're still absolutely alive. You're parallel. You're part of me. I'm part of you. And we have the same relationship to our future lives. In a completely enlightened life, I'm sure my life, next life, mine will be a completely enlightened life. So why can't I ask this future life to help me out right now? This is part of the enlightenment, you know, situation, is realizing this. So let's let our future lives help us. Some claim that the ETs are our future lives coming here to help us. I don't necessarily agree with that. They're here really to take the planet over, is what they're here for. They just want it to be nice, you know, for them. But they're not really here to help us out, you know, the way that we really want to be helped out. I don't recognize that. The evidence does not support that. It's a very clever, you know, marketing campaign on their part. Cosmic corporate culture. So let's get back to our other lives. Why not lean on them? Don't relatives help out relatives? I mean, mostly using this world, that's true, right? So, well, you're, you know, a blood relative. I mean, you know, I need help. Can I, you know, these people coming to the United States, they looking for a home. So can you help me out? You know, you're a blood relative. Can you help me out? And they say, oh, yeah, I can't turn you down. So, okay, you can stay with us and we'll take care of you and see that you get on your feet and we're always here for you and stuff. So this is what happens. They're fleeing, supposedly fleeing some terrible persecution, you know, in their, where they live. They stay, they find relatives and they stay with them. In a nicer place. Why can't we flee this world to another place and stay with relatives there? Now, I was so surprised by how I was treated. I was treated so well. I mean, they treated me like I was their long lost, you know, brother or something. I mean, I said, wow, I mean, why are you allowing me to, you know, and you've made this beautiful place. I mean, this is just extraordinarily, and you're allowing me to enjoy and appreciate this. This is, wow, why? Well, maybe they're my direct relative, you know, maybe they are me, right? Parallel life, future life, whatever you want to call it. So they recognize me as one spirit, part of their one spirit. And ultimately, we're all one spirit, but, you know, eventually we will realize this eventually. So we need to start looking at the situation like this. And this is what the Holy Spirit just has given us, a clue. That's how to look at it, right? It's a way of changing our perception of the universe. We're not aliens to these other places, not at all. We're blood relatives, as it were. We're spiritual relatives to these other dwelling places. Absolutely we are. They'd be thrilled to have us. So if we can start looking at the situation like this, maybe we say, oh, that kind of tips the balance, doesn't it, in a certain way? You know, we don't want to impose upon strangers, do we? But what if we weren't strangers to them? What if they knew of us very well and they said, wow, yeah, I know this was a previous life of mine that had a terrible trouble in this world, but you're waking up and realizing you don't have to have this terrible life. How redemptive is that? Very redemptive. Maybe they can have a role in your redemption. How great would it be for them to have a role in your redemption, you know? I mean, I'm sure they'd like nothing better. I mean, isn't it awesome that you give them an opportunity to have a role in your redemption? Absolutely. Just like my previous life is so thrilled that I've had a role in their redemption. JB, Johannes Brahms, had a role in his redemption, and he's seeing this, and he's just saying, this is just like fantastic, you know, just love it. And I love having a role in his redemption, playing a role in his redemption. I'm thrilled to be able to do this, you know, and he's thrilled that I'm able to help him out. So why wouldn't a quote-unquote future life be thrilled to play a role in our redemption? It's really their role in their redemption too. So you see, we're starting to flip the script on the world, the whole belief system of the world, aren't we? We're flipping the script here. You know, how do we know maybe Ramana Maharshi's our future self, you know? A parallel self, and he's thrilled, for instance, be thrilled to play a role in our redemption, that kind of thing. We're not strangers to him at all. You know, this kind of thing. Just to use an example. Just like I'm able to look at Johannes problems and say, look how I've solved your problems. Look how I've been able to see in a different way. Look how I've been able to liberate. You thought you were stuck. You thought you were, you know, you couldn't be free, that you did everything. And now I'm showing you, you're not stuck. You weren't stuck, you know. How awesome is that? It's great. He's able to see, oh, I really can get free of this. Oh, I really see why I was so severely, you know, so much trouble because, oh, I didn't realize the continuity problems are so severe. I didn't realize how severely we defend against it. I didn't realize that. I didn't see the bigger picture of how severe this continuity problem is. You know, so I felt like I did everything I could do, but it still wasn't enough, and I felt like a failure. Now I see I really wasn't a failure. Maybe I actually helped you out with my discipline, and indeed he did. You see, so he's able to see that he helped me be a success that I am. And so we're able to go to someone who's ultimately enlightened, for instance, our enlightened self, and we help that self get enlightened by just the tremendous discipline and effort that we put forth in this lifetime, and they're thrilled to help us. They say, my God, you helped me be enlightened. And so we're kind of collapsing time by doing this, aren't we? We're collapsing time by doing this. Bring our past lives into the picture here and help collapse time. So this is extraordinary what we're doing. And we're bringing some hope into the picture here. Oh, wait a minute. You know, maybe we're not trapped here in this world. Maybe someone in a higher dimension, you know, the death-free realm, is like saying, hey, you're the one who helped me get here. So of course I'm going to help you now. I'm going to give you a vacation here, you know? I mean, in some way, you know, can work like that, so to speak. So, we're doing great. We're doing great here. So I just want everyone to know that we're solidly on our feet here. And hope is blossoming. Hope is blossoming. Maybe I'll still... You know, I don't know what I'll do, you know, but I'll keep doing what I can do, let's put it that way. Hope is truly blossoming for us. Maybe we have much more help than we realize, in much better ways than we realize, and we would not be imposing upon that at all. Now, when you go to go to another country, and maybe it's a much more advanced country, you have third world people come to the United States or somewhere else, and they're like, oh my gosh, do I really deserve any of this? It's so incredible. I mean, it's just all this massive materiality, success, and wealth, and whatever. Oh, they think like, oh, you know, wow. But if they're disciplined, you know, people, they're good people, they have the tools to keep themselves poised and balanced, they're not going to be a problem, and they're going to realize, well, I've got a continuity issue here with this situation, so let me realize it will take me some time to get used to this, and I have to, you know, meditate, I have to contemplate, I have to, you know, say, okay, I just, you know, drove in this awesome car, you know, and it's like, well, I went to some awesome place, and everything looks so awesome, so neat and clean and nice and rich, and I need to go home, let me just center, you know, and say, okay, that's a huge wow. So let me just, don't do any more right now. That's enough. I've had enough of this. Let me get used to this. Wow. So if they manage their transition, you know, then they're not going to be a problem for you. But if they come off like as arrogant, you know, and stuff like that, then there's going to be a problem. So if we have these tools, spiritual tools, someone realizes we can manage our spiritual path, we can take care of our business, handle our business of a continuity issue, they'll say, hey, my house is your house, my place is your place, enjoy. It's like going on a beautiful golf course. It's so beautiful. And just you play one hole and you say, you know what? I just got to take a break, right? I just got to stop for a while. This is like so awesome. It's so incredible. I'm shocked by it. I had kind of a situation like that. I went out on a golf course. It was super beautiful golf course. It was super hot. Nobody was there. I had almost virtually entirely to myself. So I was just able to enjoy and look around and say, wow, this is so beautiful, so nice. So I would just stop after a certain hole or even the middle of it. I'd just stop under the shade of a tree. And I said, I'm just going to take it easy for a while. I'm just going to enjoy this. I'm going to let it sink in. I'm not going to keep playing. I'm just going to stop for a while. And nobody told me I had to keep playing. You know, this is what was so awesome. I could just stop. And you might go to a place like a world that I've seen where it's so beautiful. You might be walking through this world and you say, wow, I just need to stop here for a while. It's so beautiful. I'm just going to stop for a while and just get used to where I'm at. Nobody's telling you you have to continue on. Let me just absorb, you know, what I've already seen. People might go to beautifully out of the world like Yosemite, and the first time they've seen it, they just say, oh my, it's overwhelming. I just want to stop here for a while and just let me picnic. Let me not even look at anything. Let me just, you know, absorb the shock of this, the scope of the Yosemite. You know, it's like so, it's so stunning. If all the waterfalls are falling and everything, wow, so stunning. So let me just admit that I've been stunned by the beauty and give me some time to just get used to that. Don't force it upon me. Let me get used to it. That's great. Fine. This is wisdom. This is wisdom. So if we're aware of the continuity issue, we can go into better and better, really great, better and better situations, and we can handle it bit by bit. We understand. We stay humble. And this is what is required, to stay humble. And our situations can improve drastically, actually. We don't need to subject ourselves to this hideous marketing campaign that's coming. So keep your spirits half full, wide open, not frightened, not defensive, saying, you know, this is great, it's getting better and better and better and better and better. And this is how we're able then to entertain more and more clarity, see our options better and better and better, and gradually become aware of what our options really are. You know? So we're in a great place. We're in a great place here. And it'll get better and better and better, probably fast. So stay with it. Okay, that's it for this one.